Well, brethren, this evening we're going to look at the book of John in a particular way here at this Bible study. Let me just sort of preface by saying that John refers to tabernacles. There's a connection with the Feast of Tabernacles in an interesting way in the book of John. I think, of course, we're all aware that John talks about in John chapter 7 about Jesus going up to the Feast of Tabernacles. But John makes an interesting expression that he uses that none of the others use. And it's obscured in the King James translation, but it is brought out in some, and you can check it up. This is in John chapter 1, where he, of course, starts out talking about that Jesus Christ was the Word. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Now he goes on in John chapter 1 and verse 14, and he said, "The Word was made flesh," and the King James translates it, "and dwelt among us." But if you look the word up, the Greek word is actually the Greek word for tabernacled. And that's what it literally says. The Word was made flesh and tabernacled among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now that's sort of interesting because John uses that exact word back in the book of Revelation, writing a while later, when he described in Revelation 21, seeing a new heaven and a new earth, seeing the new Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven, as he mentions in Revelation 21, 2, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. "And I heard a great voice out of heaven," John wrote, "saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will tabernacle with them. And they will be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God." Jesus Christ came in the flesh to tabernacle among us. Ultimately, when we're made spirit, the new heavens and the new earth come about. God himself, God the Father, will come down, and he, at that point, will tabernacle with us. So sort of an interesting expression. The Gospel of John was written later. It was written really virtually a generation later than all of the other Gospels. The Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke were probably all written within a relatively short period of one another, maybe a period of 10, 12, 15 years, something in that neighborhood that they were was the time period. Most of the commentators will say that Mark was first or different ones. They have all their various theories. I think when you really put the story together that Matthew was probably the one that was written first because Matthew was written to the Jews. It was written to the Jewish community, and it stressed Jesus' association with the prophecies of the Old Testament. Matthew quotes the Old Testament more extensively than any other New Testament book other than Revelation and Hebrews. I think Matthew and Hebrews are probably about similar. Revelation is slightly more. So Matthew focuses in and ties it in with the Jewish community. Mark writes a very direct story, and it is the gospel that was used primarily in the area where Peter traveled. Mark was Peter's traveling companion for, let's say, some of the latter part of Peter's ministry. Luke was written. Luke, of course, was Paul's traveling companion. And the gospel of Luke was written primarily for the areas where Paul was traveling. Now, all of this was done between about 50 A.D. and the on in the early 60s A.D. when Luke wrote the book of Luke, and then actually he wrote a two-volume set, the Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts. And if you read the introduction to both of them, they were addressed in a way that was sort of a two-volume set. Well, it was many years later. It was about 30 years later that John wrote yet a fourth gospel. And John is writing to a different generation, because Matthew, Mark, and Luke were all written prior to the destruction of Jerusalem, prior to the Jerusalem church being dispersed, prior to those events. John is written many years later, in the 90s AD. By the time John wrote, virtually the entire first generation of Christians had passed. There were undoubtedly a few still around, but they were very elderly, because John himself was 90 or above at that point. So the first generation, the generation that really had direct contact, was pretty well gone. And John is writing to second and third and even fourth generation Christians who are on the scene. John wrote from Ephesus, a city in Asia Minor. So he's writing at a much later time. He's writing when different issues have come on the scene, different things. By this time, a lot of what are called the Gnostic heresies have begun to surface. John addresses the subject in a different manner than the others. He had no need to go back and to cover exactly the same things. It's sort of interesting when you go through carefully, you find that John only overlapped with the others on just a very few things. John told the story of John the Baptist and his baptism of Jesus. All four of the Gospels tell that. John tells the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000. Interesting, that is the only miracle that's mentioned in all four of the Gospels. He told the story of Jesus and the feeding of the 5,000. And of course, John focused in on the events of Jesus' final Passover. But when John told the story of Jesus' final Passover, he told it in a different way. He did not cover a lot of the things that the others had covered, the Olivet prophecy and things like that. He didn't cover the Sermon on the Mount early in Jesus' ministry. He did not choose to cover most of the things that the others had, because at the time John was writing, those Gospels were there. He didn't need to go back and just rehash that. He was writing to focus in on different things. I want to show you some of the things that are unique about the Gospel of John this evening, and I want to show you the theme that runs throughout the book of John. There is one word that is used over 50 times in the book of John. It is used in almost every chapter of the book of John, and it is used over 50 times. And that is a word that runs through, and we're going to look and see what that is, because that is a theme that John stressed throughout his gospel, and he picked up that theme and developed it also in the particularly in 1 John. But John, of course, focused in on Jesus' final Passover, the events of his crucifixion and his resurrection. But again, stressing the aspects of the story that were not commented on a lot by the other gospel writers. Now, let me show you a few things in the Gospel of John. You know, John doesn't tell anything about the human birth of Jesus. He doesn't talk about Mary and Joseph and the going to Bethlehem and all of those things. That story had already been told. John starts out by emphasizing who Jesus of Nazareth really was. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Without Him was not anything made that was made. So John lays emphasis on who Jesus of Nazareth really was. His real origin, that he was from heaven. Now, one of the things that's interesting in the Gospel of John is John focuses in primarily on what Jesus said and did in the context of seven festival seasons. Now, you know, a lot of folks think that, of course, the holy days and the Sabbath was all done away. Well, here's John writing decades after everything that was done away had long since been done away. And John focuses in almost in his entire book what Jesus said and did during seven festival seasons in his life. You notice that here in John chapter 2 when you pick it up in verse 13, we're told the Jews' Passover was at hand and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. So John 1 has sort of set the stage. Now we pick up in John 2 the events of the Passover. Jesus comes up to Jerusalem. This is the cleansing of the temple at the beginning of his ministry. Now the other three gospel accounts tell the story of his cleansing of the temple at the end of his ministry. And some of the commentators scratch their heads and say, well, you know, John must have got that mixed up, or they're all, they try to telescope it together. Well, what's so complicated about the fact that he cleansed the temple twice? Clearly, John says that it happened at the beginning of his ministry. He did it again at the end of his ministry. And we'll comment a little more on that later. But he came up, it was the Passover season. Now, what do you do right before Passover? You clean your house, don't you? Well, Jesus cleaned his Father's house, you know. And this created quite a stir. He was, verse 23 of John 2, he was in Jerusalem at the Passover in the feast day, and many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. Now, let me comment here, and I'm going to come back to this point. There's more than one word in the Greek language that is used for miracle. Dunamos is one. It's the word, Greek word, that our English word dynamic or dynamo comes from, and that is often translated or referenced to a miracle. This word is a different word, and it is a word that is also translated sign in the Gospel of John, and that's literally what it means. It has to do with a miraculous sign. It is a sign of something, and in this context, it is a miraculous sign. All signs don't always have to be miraculous, but John uses that term here to refer to miraculous signs. Jesus cleansed the temple, and then he taught in the temple during the Passover season, and he performed many miracles, many miraculous signs during that time. Well, the result of that is you just flow right on into chapter 3. Nicodemus comes to him by night and says, we know that you're a teacher sent from God because nobody can do the signs that you do except God be with him. And Jesus' discussion with Nicodemus is in the context of the first Passover season of his ministry. That is the context in which the words of John 3:16 were spoken. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Well, doesn't that sum up the meaning of the Passover? Isn't that what the Passover is to a great extent about? Well, that's what Jesus was teaching. Here, John records the events and the teachings connected with the first Passover of Jesus' ministry. Then he goes on through the story of how that after this, Jesus, after the Passover, verse 22 of John 3, tarried there in the area of Judea and baptized for a few weeks. Well, if you come on down through the story, when John was put in prison later on that spring, the other Gospels make plain that when John was put in prison, Jesus went up to Galilee. I think Mark brings that out, after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. Well, John is the only one that tells the story of his journey from Judea up to Galilee. In order to get from Judea to Galilee, the most direct route is through Samaria. And that story is told in John 4. And you have to look a little carefully in John 4 to realize this was spoken just prior to a holy day season. Because if Jesus was baptizing after the Passover for a few weeks, John was put in prison that spring, Jesus left and is on his way back up to Galilee, then what holy day season was coming up? Well, it was Pentecost. Luke is the one who actually brings out that Jesus was in the synagogue in Nazareth at the service there on Pentecost and spoke the words of Luke chapter 4, proclaiming, announcing his ministry in Galilee, announcing the acceptable year of the Lord. And if you look carefully, it's again not obvious in most of the English translations. It says just normally he was in the synagogue on the Sabbath, but if you look it up, it is a plural form. He was in the synagogue literally on the day of the Sabbaths, on the day of Sabbaths or Pentecost. The Feast of Weeks is what the Jews called it. John 4 tells the story of Jesus' encounter with the woman at the well in Samaria. And what was he talking about? Rivers of living water, right? He talked about, if you knew who it was that asked of you for water, you'd ask me and I'd give you living water. This he was talking of the Holy Spirit. Now, here's another aspect of dating it. How do we know, from John's account in John 4, this was right before Pentecost? Well, Jesus made a comment to his disciples. They had gone into town to buy food. He had stayed out there, was talking with the woman. By the time they got back with the food, a crowd was assembling, and Jesus was caught up in that. And, they were ready to eat. And they said, Lord, let's take a break. Let's go ahead and eat. He said, I've got food to eat that you don't even know anything about. Well, they didn't get the point. They said, oh, somebody bring him food we didn't know about? He said, my meat, my food, is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. This is John 4:34. And then notice verse 35. Don't you say there are yet 4 months and then comes harvest? Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields. They're white already to harvest. Well, what was the time when the harvest was celebrated? The beginning of the seventh month. 4 months earlier would bring you to the beginning of the third month. Pentecost always comes in the first week, somewhere about a week into the third month. Jesus stayed on in Samaria, as it says here, for a couple of days, and then he was on his way on up to Nazareth. And you read that story here. So Jesus' teaching, and you read John 4 carefully, and you get a lot about the meaning of Pentecost. When you get into John chapter 5, we're told, after this there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And we're not told what this feast was, but the teaching that Jesus gave during this time would certainly tie in with the fall festival season. He talks about in John 5:28, marvel not at this, the hour is coming in which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice and shall come forth. He talks about the resurrection. That's his theme here. When you get into John 6, we find the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. John, one of the only parallel accounts that he gives with the other Gospels, is he tells about the feeding of the 5,000. But John adds in an important part of the story that none of the others mention. He mentions that it was done just before Passover, that Jesus fed the 5,000 with the loaves and the fishes. And then Jesus crossed the sea, crossed over to Capernaum, and the crowd caught up with him, and then he begins to teach them about the bread of God, the bread of life. And it was what he was teaching in the synagogue. John 6:59. These things he said in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. See, John ties in this miracle with the Passover season. He mentions that it was Passover was getting close, John 6:4. And then he gives what Jesus taught to the crowd in the aftermath. And certainly gives emphasis to the spiritual meaning of the days of unleavened bread. As Jesus talks about that, you know, it's not enough to get rid of something. You've got to replace it with something else, don't you? If we get rid of sin, well, what do we do? Did God give us the days of no bread at all? You know? No. Because just as we are to get rid of the leavening of malice and wickedness, we're to replace it with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth, which is personified by Jesus Christ, the bread of God, the living bread, the bread that came down from heaven. Well, John 6 talks about the Passover season. John 7 tells us, verse 2, now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. And you come on through John 7, and you have Jesus teaching on the Feast of Tabernacles as he explained about certain things that the importance of going up to the feast, and goes through teaching here. Then when you get to verse 37, John 7:37, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried aloud, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Now, there's sometimes been confusion. There have been those who said, well, you know, maybe this is talking about the last day of the Feast of Tabernacles. Well, let me ask you a question. Feast of Tabernacles is 7 days, right? Only one of those 7 days is a holy day, right? God said the first day of the Feast of Tabernacles is a holy convocation. It is a Sabbath. How in the world could you call the 7th day of the Feast of Tabernacles, which is not even a holy day, how could you call that the great day of the seven? How could a non-holy day be greater than a holy day? I think the only logical conclusion, you can come to illogical conclusions, but I think the only logical conclusion is that it was just exactly as we have traditionally explained it, as Mr. Armstrong understood it, and that is that it is the 8th day. You know, interestingly enough, that was the one holy day the Jews understood the least about. They called it the 8th day of solemn assembly. And they really had less clue. They understood somewhat the meaning of virtually all the other days. That one they understood the least about. And if you notice here, beginning in John 7:37, Jesus is teaching. Now this is the evening portion, the evening that opens the last great day. How do we know that? Well, it ends, notice chapter 7 verse 53, every man went unto his own house. Chapter 8, verse 1, just continuing right on. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives. And early in the morning, he came again into the temple. So obviously what he said first was what he taught on that evening. And he's talking about the Spirit of God being available, rivers of living water. Then he comes into the temple early in the morning. This would be the daylight portion. Now, one other thing that ties in with this, as you see a little later on down, this healing of the blind man that occurs on in John chapter 9 actually occurred on the there's a reference to the fact that it was the Sabbath. The last Feast of Tabernacles of Jesus' ministry, which is clearly, if you go through John 8, 9, 10, just follow the sequence through as we're going to do. This was the last Feast of Tabernacles of his ministry, the Feast of Tabernacles 30 A.D. The Feast of, in the year 30 A.D., the first day of the Feast of Tabernacles and the last great day came on the weekly Sabbath. Just anyway, notice here, early in the morning, they come into the temple. The Pharisees bring a woman taken in adultery. And they say, you know, Moses said to stone her, what do you say? Well, you know the story. You know, Jesus says, stoop down, wrote on the ground. Doesn't say what he wrote. But they started slinking out, beginning with the oldest all the way to the youngest. I don't know exactly what he wrote. I have my idea. I think he may have written a few names and dates and places. Whatever he wrote made the folks that were standing there very uncomfortable and sort of took all the starch out of them. And it didn't take very long before they were all gone. Because Jesus just said, you know, when they pressed him for an answer, he said, let him that has no sin cast the first stone. I think, you know, one of you without sin needs to cast the first stone. It says he stooped back down and started writing. Well, I don't know what he wrote, but whatever it was, they didn't want to stay around and discuss the subject any further. Then what did he tell the woman? He said, you know, where are your accusers? Okay, there are none of them here. Oh, okay. Well, neither do I condemn you. He said, go and sin no more. Now, let me ask you something. What is the symbolism of the last great day? Is not this woman a personification of all humanity that's going to be brought before Christ, having been taken in sin in the very act, brought before Christ? And what's his message going to be? The same as it was on that last great day of his ministry. Go and sin no more. I'm going to give you an opportunity to change. Very interesting if you read that through. Just come right on down through the story. He gets into a discussion about the truth. Then at the end of John 8:59, by this time they're mad. They take up stones ready to cast them at him. He goes out of the temple. And going through the midst of them, he passed by, and as he passed by, just go right on into chapter 9, as he passed by, he saw a man that was blind from birth. So we're looking at detailed events that all occurred on the same day. Tells what happened that evening, tells what happened starting early the next morning, comes on down, he leaves the temple, now he encounters the man blind from birth. He heals him, opens his eyes. Now, he draws a spiritual conclusion from that, because he said in verse 39 of John 9, Jesus said, for judgment I'm come into the world, that they which see not might see. Now, isn't that part of the meaning of the last great day? Isn't that a time when those that see not will see? People who have been spiritually blinded are now going to have their eyes opened. Some of the Pharisees, verse 40, they heard him and they said, are we blind? And Jesus said, if you were blind, you'd have no sin. But now you say, we see. Therefore, your sin remains. The last great day is not a second chance. It's a first chance. If you never had a chance to see, you're going to get your eyes opened. Those who saw and chose to reject what they saw, that's a different matter. So Jesus went right on with his teaching on this subject here in John chapter 10, explaining that there's only one way. I'm the door. You don't get to the Father except by me. There are not many ways of salvation. All the good Buddhists can go to heaven, and all the good Hindus, and all the good Catholics, and all the good Muslims, and you know, no. Jesus said, and again, you tie right back into the last great day. It's not that, well, you can just sort of get there however, you know. No, everybody's going to have to get there the same way. You go through and you have a very detailed expounding of the spiritual principles of this day that was the least understood, and John spends more time explaining what Jesus said and taught in the context of that holy day, because nowhere else in the Bible up until then was a whole lot explained on the subject. In fact, nowhere else in the Bible was virtually anything explained on the subject, except that it was the eighth day and you were supposed to keep it. Well, as you go on in, Jesus leaves Jerusalem, comes back briefly in the winter, about 2 or 3 months later, at the time of the Feast of Dedication, or Hanukkah, the celebration of the rededication of the temple that had occurred about 2 centuries before Jesus ministry here. Then Jesus leaves again very quickly, is gone for a month or 6 weeks, hears about Lazarus, comes and raises Lazarus from the dead, and then disappears again very quickly. And when we end up in chapter 11, verse 55, the Jews' Passover was near at hand, and he goes up to Jerusalem, and this is the final Passover of his ministry. So you open with a Passover in John chapters 2 and 3, have a Pentecost season in chapter 4, fall festival season in chapter 5, Passover teaching about the bread of life in chapter 6, Feast of Tabernacles in chapter 7, the last great day in the last part of 7, all of 8, all of 9, part of 10. Then by the time you get to the end of John 11, you're coming to the 7th, the final Passover season of Jesus' ministry, and the entire rest of the book of John is devoted to that. So John seemed to think it was important for the church to understand what Jesus said and taught regarding the holy days. Now let me show you something else. John, right at the end of the Gospel of John, in John chapter 21, well, chapter 20, John 20, verse 30. Many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. John did not write every sign that Jesus performed. Verse 31. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Did you know that John recorded 7 signs of Jesus' Messiahship? Here. Let me show you. Going back here to the Gospel of John in chapter 2. John tells about them going up to the marriage that took place in Cana of Galilee. And tells about the marriage. John's the only one. You remember the story. They ran out of wine, and Mary, Jesus' mother, told the servants, you know, she came, told Jesus about the problem, and she told the servants, she said, well, now whatever he tells you, just do it. Jesus told them to go fill up all the pots with water and go take that to the governor of the feast. Well, now, you know, evidently these servants had an awful lot of respect for Jesus' mother because they did that. Now, if you're a servant working somewhere, you know, you think of you're having a big banquet here and you got a waiter and you order wine and he goes back in the kitchen and you're out of wine. Somebody says, here, fill up this with water and take it to him. Okay. So he went and he filled it with water and took it. And when he got there, well, guess what? It wasn't water anymore. The water was made wine. Chapter 2, verse 9 says, the ruler of the feast had tasted the water made wine. He didn't know where it came from, but the servants that drew the water, they knew. And notice verse 11. This beginning of miracles, or this beginning of signs, the word that's translated miracle here is the same word that's translated sign back later in the Gospel of John, where it says, many other signs Jesus did. But these are recorded that you might know. All right. This is the beginning of signs. The first sign was turning water into wine. He manifested his glory, and his disciples believed on him. This was the first sign of his messiahship. You go on through the story a little bit later, and we find that he did many signs, as it mentions in John 2:23 and John 3:2, but none of them are mentioned specifically. When you get back a little further, we find that verse 46 of John 4:46, Jesus came again into Cana of Galilee, where he had made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went to him, besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. Jesus said unto them, except you see signs and wonders, you'll not believe. And the nobleman said, sir, please come down. He's going to die if you don't come. And Jesus said, go your way, your son lives. The man believed the word that Jesus had spoken. He went, his servants met him. They said, your son lives. And he inquired, he said, when did he start getting better? And they told him, and the father knew that it was the same hour in which Jesus said, your son lives. Verse 54, this is again the second sign. The word sign is actually the word that's used here. It's rendered miracle in some translations, but it is that same word for sign. This is again the second sign that Jesus did when he was come out of Judea into Galilee. So we start out and John is numbering. He says, this is the first sign, water to wine. Healing of the nobleman's son, that's the second sign. Now, John doesn't number the rest of them, but when you go on through and just count the ones that are mentioned, you find that there are seven in all. And John sort of clues us in by numbering the first two. Oh, he's counting these. He didn't try to list all that he did. The ones he listed had significance. See, look, in chapter 5, we find in verse 7, this impotent man, a man who is powerless. He can't get up. He can't move. Poor fellow, just laying there. He's been this way for years. He had had this infirmity 38 years. And Jesus told him, verse 8, rise, take your bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole. Now, what we find is you start going through, you come on a little bit further. In chapter 6, and there's a whole crowd of people. They've been there all day, and nobody has anything to eat. And Jesus said, how are we going to provide for all these people? And Philip, you know, he asked questions. Sometimes you ask a question, and it's not because you don't know the answer. It's because you want to find out what the other fellow is going to say. So he asked Philip. He said, Philip, where in the world are we going to get enough food to feed all these folks? And Philip said, verse 7, Lord, 200 pennies worth of bread is not sufficient for them. And then everybody just have a little bit. Why, you could spend the equivalent of about a year's wages. And you couldn't, I mean, you just have a little bit to give everybody. Andrew, who was standing by, said, only food I've seen is some little kid. He's got five little barley loaves and two little fish, two small fish. You know, and what's that among so many? And Jesus said, well, tell everybody to sit down. And so there were about 5,000 men that sat down. This was in addition, the other Gospels bring out, this was in addition to the women and children. Jesus took the loaves and the fish, and he gave thanks. And he passed out, had the disciples pass out the food. And verse 12, they were filled. They were filled. Had plenty and took up 12 baskets full of the fragments that remained. Verse 14, then those men, when they had seen the sign, same word, the sign that Jesus did, they said, this is of a truth, that prophet that's come into the world. Now let's look a little bit. Here we are to the fourth sign that's mentioned. The first one was he turned water into wine. How are these signs of the Messiah? Think about it. Well, you know, wine at the feast was symbolic of joy. A symbolic of celebration and joy. The Messiah is the source of joy. Well, come a little further. What was the second sign? He healed this poor man's son. The Messiah is the source of joy. The Messiah is the source of healing. Come on down. When you get to the third sign, you find this poor man powerless to move. The Messiah is the source of power. Here's a man who's powerless, And the Messiah is the source of power. Now you find people that are hungry, and the Messiah is the one who can provide all your needs. He can feed you. He can provide your needs. He's the source of joy. He's the source of healing. He's the source of power. He's the source of providing your needs, providing your daily bread. Now, if you come on a little further, we find in chapter 9, this is the story of the man blind from birth. And the Messiah healed him. John 9:16. Therefore said some of the Pharisees, "This man is not of God, because he doesn't keep the Sabbath day." Others said, "How can a man that is a sinner do such signs?" Same word. And there was a division among them. The fifth sign that John chose to record was the healing of the blind. See, the Messiah is not only the one who is the source and the provider of joy, not only the one who is our healer, who is the one who can empower the powerless and feed and provide for those who are unable to meet their needs, he's the one who can open our eyes. He can enable us to see. Well, you come through, and in chapter 11, we read about the sixth sign that John records. That's the story of Lazarus. Lazarus was sick. Word got to Jesus that Lazarus was sick. Jesus had been in Jerusalem at the Feast of Dedication, which was basically in December, and they were mad. The Jewish religious leadership, they had been gunning for him since the Feast of Tabernacles. He showed up briefly there at the time in the winter, and he left. And now he gets word. He's gone over to the Jordan River, sort of in a little more of a remote area away from Jerusalem. He gets word that Lazarus is sick. He purposely waits for a couple of days. Then he tells the disciples, "Come on, let's go. We're going to go wake up Lazarus." Well, it's interesting. He says, "Come on, let's go." And you know, some of the disciples had first said, "Well, look, Lord," here in verse 8, his disciples said, "Lord, you know, the Jews, last time we were up there in Jerusalem, the Jews sought to stone you. You want to go up there again? You know, that may not be a good idea. They were throwing rocks the last time." Jesus said, "Come on, let's go. We're going to go to Jerusalem." And old Thomas, you know, the Bible doesn't tell you a whole lot about Thomas, but I think one thing you can deduce from what we are told, Thomas was not the founder of the Optimist Club. Thomas's comment when Jesus said, "No, we're going to Jerusalem," Thomas's comments recorded in verse 16. He looked at the others and he said, "Well, we might as well go with him that we may die with him. You're going to go up there and get killed. We'll probably all get killed. Come on, let's go. We'll just all die together." Thomas was just not a real naturally optimistic sort of fella. So they got up there they really didn't go to Jerusalem, but when you're in Bethany, you're just a couple of miles away. You're just on the outskirts. It's a little village, and just a slight distance from the old city. Well, Jesus came up, and he really didn't even go directly into town. He sort of waited out of town, talked to Martha. She went back and got Mary, but when she went back and got Mary, the whole crowd of folks that were in the house came out too. And so they all met out there in the air, out of town, where in the cemetery where Lazarus was buried. And you remember the story. Jesus then told Lazarus, who by that time had been dead for 4 days. See, he didn't want to show up and just sort of heal him right before he died. Didn't even want to show up right after he died and heal him, you know, raise him immediately. People say, "Well, maybe we just thought Lazarus was dead." No, let's wait 4 days. He's dead. You know, nobody disputes that. He told them to open the tomb. They said, Lord, you don't want to open the tomb. You know, it stinks now. I mean, he's been dead 4 days. He told them, move the stone. They moved the stone. He said, Lazarus, come forth. Verse 43 of John 11. This is the sixth sign. See, notice what happened. People saw it. Some of them went and told the Pharisees. Verse 47, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered a council and they said, what are we going to do? This man does many signs. Many signs. This is the sixth one that's recorded. If we let him alone, everybody's going to believe on him. Now John said, you know, we read right at the end of the book of John, he said, I'm recording the, Jesus did more signs, a lot more signs than what I'm recording. But I'm recording these signs so that you might know who he is, that you might believe. So now we get up to the sixth sign. Lazarus has come forth out of the grave. So the Messiah turned water to wine. He healed the nobleman's son. He raised the powerless man who was unable to move himself. He fed the multitude. He opened the eyes of the blind, and now he raised the dead. So we've been sort of growing in intensity of what has been done, these signs that have been recorded. And this is the last except for one. Of course, you know what the seventh sign was. That was the empty tomb. That was the fact that Jesus himself came forth. You know, when Lazarus came forth from the grave, Lazarus was still a human being and he continued to live and grew older and eventually died. When Jesus came forth, it was to live forevermore. That was the ultimate sign. And that is what Jesus told the Pharisees. That's recorded in the other Gospels. See, John is writing to people who've already read the other Gospels. So a lot of things that he refers to based on the fact that he knew that his readers already had heard that story. So he doesn't have to go back and tell it from scratch. He just refers to it. Anybody who had read the other Gospels knew what? The Pharisees at the beginning of Jesus' ministry said, give us a sign. Give us a sign. He said, no sign will be given you except the sign of the prophet Jonah. He was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish. I'll be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Have you ever thought about the fact of how in such a unique way that was a sign directly to the Pharisees and religious leaders? The proof of that, Matthew's account tells us, what? That when Jesus was buried on the morning of the holy day, the Pharisees and the chief priests came to Pilate, and they said, look, this deceiver said that after 3 days and three nights, I'm going to rise from the dead. What we're afraid of is his disciples are going to come steal his body, claim that he's raised from the dead, and then the latter trouble is going to be worse than the beginning. We want some guards. We want some Roman soldiers to guard the tomb to make sure nobody breaks in. Pilate said, okay, you can have your soldiers. They went and they sealed the tomb. They not only brought soldiers, they brought workmen. These were the guys that were so bent out of shape when Jesus healed a blind man on the Sabbath. They got somebody out there mixing up mortar, sealing the tomb. And so they seal it. They make it sure. That's the only way you can do it. So you seal it, you mix up your mortar, and you trowel it around, and you seal it, and then you post guards. Now, you remember the story. You see, they were sealing the tomb to ensure nobody broke in. They didn't need to worry about anybody breaking in. It wasn't anybody who was going to break in. It was somebody that was going to break out. He already left. He didn't need to open the door to leave. They opened the door so everybody could see that he was gone. The angel showed up and did that. The guards, of course, fainted dead away. Then, you remember what? They went back to the folks that hired them, and they told them the story. So you see, it was a direct sign to them because they handpicked the men that were their witnesses, put them there at the tomb. Their witnesses came back and told them what happened. So they had a direct witness from their handpicked men. And they bribed them and said, "We want you to tell everybody that you just went to sleep." Well, if I bribe you to do something, there are always going to be two of us that know it's a lie. Me and you, right? You may convince somebody else. So it's interesting. You see, that was, of course, the ultimate sign of Jesus' Messiahship. So John records these seven signs. He talks about these holy days. Something else John records. John wants you to know who Jesus is. John records something else in the Gospel of John. He records what are called the seven I am statements. Jesus defined who he was. He said in John chapter 6, verse 35, Jesus said unto them, "I am the bread of life. I'm the bread of life. I'm the bread that came down from heaven. I am what you must consume in order to live. I am the bread of life." Well, he emphasizes that in John chapter 6. If you come on back a little bit further here, and let's see. Where Jesus went on to, let's see here. I'm skipping one. Oh yeah, here in John chapter 8 and verse 12. Jesus spoke unto them and he said, "I am the light of the world. He that follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world." If you come on back a little bit later in John chapter 10 and verse 7, Jesus said, "I am the door of the sheep." You know, I'm the door, verse 9. "By me, if any man enter in, he'll be saved. He'll go in and out and find pasture." Jesus said, "I'm the door. I'm the only way to get in and out. I'm the only one, I'm the only way that you can get to the Father. I am the door." Then he went on in verse 11, and he said, "I'm the good shepherd. I'm the bread of life. I'm the light of the world. I'm the door of the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I'm the one who's there to take care of you, to watch over you, to lay down my life for the sheep." Well, you come on back just a little bit further, and we see yet another of the statements that where Jesus brought out in verse 25 of chapter 11. He said, "I am the resurrection and the life." So not only am I the light of the world, or am I the bread of life? Am I the light of the world? Am I the door of the sheep? Am I the good shepherd? I am the resurrection and the life. In chapter 14 and verse 6, Jesus said unto them, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." I'm the way. And the final, the seventh I am statement is in chapter 15 and verse 1. "I am the true vine." So Jesus defined by his own statements what he is. He's the bread of life. He's the light of the world. He's the door. He is the good shepherd. He is the resurrection. He He is the one. He is the way. He is the vine, the true vine, to whom we must all be attached. Now, John said that his purpose in writing this book, as he expresses it in John chapter 20, in verse 30, many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. So John was selective. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Now, believe is the theme that runs all the way through the Gospel of John. This is John's purpose for writing the book. He wrote it because he wanted you to know who Jesus was. He said, you know, I'm the last eyewitness. I'm the last person alive on this earth that really can tell you firsthand. I know. So he recorded what Jesus said about himself, because by this time all sorts of errors and teachings and Gnostic philosophies were extant, and everybody had their theory. John said, I can tell you who Jesus was. Let me tell you what he said. He said, I am the bread of life. I am. And he went through and he gave you seven I am statements that Jesus made, defining himself. Not just somebody's theory about who they thought Jesus was, but who Jesus himself said that he was. What evidence do you have that he's really the Messiah, the Son of God? John said, there are all sorts of signs I could give you, but I'm going to record seven of them. Because if these seven don't prove it, there's no point in mentioning any others. You're not going to listen to them. But he said, I can tell you about these seven because I was there. I saw all seven of them. I'm an eyewitness to it. And he said, it's written that you might believe. The word believe, or a form of the word believe, is used well over 50 times in the Gospel of John. It's used in almost every single chapter. I think there may be two chapters in the book of John where the word does not occur. Let me just show you briefly as we go through in the concluding part. In John chapter 1, in verse 6, we read, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. So why did God send John the Baptist to bear witness of Jesus? That everybody through his testimony might believe. Well, Jesus was in the world, verse 10. The world was made by him. The world knew him not. He came to his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Now let me comment a little bit. When we're talking about believing, you know, it says on down just a little bit later in John chapter 2, when Jesus performed this miracle at Galilee, or at Cana rather, Cana of Galilee, the water to wine, that his disciples believed on him. And it goes on and explains something else where Jesus quoted the statement about destroy this temple and I will raise it up. In 3 days I'll raise it up, John 2:19. And the Jews, of course, did not understand what he meant. They thought he acted as though he were talking about the physical temple there in Jerusalem. Verse 21, but he spoke of the temple of his body. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered what he had said unto them, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had said. See, they believed the scripture as a result of what Jesus had done. In John 3:15, Jesus speaking to Nicodemus said that the Son of Man must be lifted up, this is the end of verse 14, that whosoever believes in him, John 3:15, whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now let's stop and just talk about believe for a minute. You know, a lot of people talk about believe. The Protestants use the term quite often. In fact, they claim that because we believe in the law of God, we're gathered here keeping the Feast of Tabernacles. And he said, well, you're just legalist. You know, you're just trying to earn your salvation. You think you can just keep that old law and earn your salvation? Well, no, that's not what we think. You know, it's amazing if you tell a Protestant minister that you observe the weekly Sabbath, he will often tell you that you're trying to get salvation by works. You're trying to earn your salvation. Can you imagine that same Protestant minister getting up and telling his people, all you folks out there that aren't committing adultery, that are keeping the seventh commandment, you're just trying to earn your salvation. All you people out there that aren't killing people, that are keeping the sixth commandment, you're just trying to earn your salvation. Well, no, they wouldn't say that. You know, it's amazing. They go down and they apply reasoning to one commandment. They don't apply it to the others. What is meant by belief? You know, the John 3:16, if you really understand it, ties in the Passover and the days of unleavened bread. See, again, the Protestant explanation is Jesus did it all for you. You know, he died. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. That's not the end of the verse. Now, that is the Passover. See, God took the initiative. He gave his only begotten Son. Jesus Christ came as the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. But do you have to do anything? John 3:16 says you do. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him, the sacrifice of Christ doesn't do you any good if you don't believe, does it? Now, what kind of belief are we talking about? You know, James says, Gospel of James, or the book of James, the Epistle of James, he says, you believe there's one God? You do well. The demons also believe and tremble. So, are the demons saved because they believe? No. Because their faith is a dead faith. You know, if all you do is, quote, believe in that sense, then you're not even one step up on the devil. He believes. He believes that Jesus is the Son of God. He knows that. Remember in some of the gospel accounts when Jesus was casting demons out and he commanded the demons that they were not to say anything because it says the demons knew that he was the Christ? Actually uses that phrase, the demons knew that he was the Christ. But you see, James explains faith without works is dead. You say you have faith? You know, show me your faith by your works. Because faith without works is dead. The only kind of faith that'll save somebody is living faith. Paul explains it in Romans chapter 10. Let's just hold our spot and come there, because I think it's important to understand this. It is a term that is misused, and we need to understand how the Bible defines it. You know, what do you have to do? What's necessary for salvation? Believe. That's right. But notice what kind of belief. Romans 10, verse 9. That if you shall confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness. The kind of belief he's talking about is belief from the heart. Not just academic knowledge, just not, you know, Satan the devil knows as a fact that God exists. He's not an atheist. He knows there's a God, right? He knows Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The demons knew that. That's why they came out when he told them to. They knew who was speaking. They knew that he had authority. One time they begged him, don't put us in the abyss yet. They knew who he was. But you see, the kind of saving faith is what is called here, if you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Why? Because If you believe it from the heart, with the heart man believes unto righteousness. If you believe it deep down inside, it will change your life. If it doesn't change your life, then you don't believe it very deeply. If you really know and know that you know that Jesus Christ came forth out of that grave, He ascended to heaven and He's coming back to this earth, it will change your life. Because ultimately you and I act on what we believe most deeply. I can tell you I believe something all day, but if I don't act on it, then it's evident that I don't believe it very deeply. You know, they warned people that storm was coming back when Isabel hit the coast. You know, and they warned people, said, hey, big hurricane is hitting. You better get out. You out here on the Outer Banks, you better leave. It's going to really, you know, we think it's going to be devastating. Now, the people who believed that left. And there were those who said, I don't think it'll be that bad. I don't really believe it's that dangerous. I'm just going to stay put. Some of them survived and some of them, you know, there were a few deaths. The point is that if you really believe something in your heart, you will act on it. So when John is talking about believing in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, he's not talking about just spouting the words. He's talking about the kind of belief that comes from your heart. You know it and it changes your life because you believe that. That is the ultimate reality. Far more real than anything you can taste and touch and see and feel. Far more real than what you can discern with the physical senses. You know, the only kind of obedience that will endure is obedience that flows from a heart that loves and trusts God. If you really trust the Father, you trust Him. You will follow Him and you will obey Him because you believe He's right. If you believe He's right, then you act on what He said. Nobody can be in the family if they don't trust the Father. How in the world is God going to build a family that's going to live in harmony and peace forever? Because the only ones who can be in the family are the ones that trust the Father. If everybody in the family trusts the Father, then whatever the Father says, that settles it forever. Anytime throughout eternity, anything ever comes up, all the Father has to do is say, this is the way we're going to do it. Everybody totally trusts the Father. Because nobody gets in the family if they don't trust the Father. That's why it says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. You know, the Pharisees prided themselves on obedience. Oh, if you'd asked them, do you think the law's done away? Absolutely not. What did they do when they got scared? Well, they hired false witnesses to try to get rid of Jesus, didn't they? Now, does that violate the law? Well, the law says you shall not bear false witness. That's one of the big ten. If I hire somebody to lie, isn't that bearing false witness? And not only that, they're taking an oath in the name of God, which is taking God's name in vain. You can go right down a direct violation of more than one of the Ten Commandments was involved. But you know what precipitated it? John tells you, he says when Lazarus was risen from the dead, when Jesus raised Lazarus, people went and told the Pharisees, they got together with the chief priests and they said, you know, we're into it now. Word of this gets out and everybody is going to believe on him. And then you know what's going to happen? The Romans are going to hear about it. And they're going to come and take away our place and our nation. We're going to lose everything. We've got to get rid of him. The Romans were more real to them than God was. They acted on what they believed. Ultimately, you and I will always act on what we really deeply believe. Sometimes you sort of believe in this and sort of believe in that. The Pharisees believed in God, but they believed in the Romans, and when push came to shove, they believed in the Romans more than they believed in God. And so they didn't obey God because they were trying to protect themselves with the Romans. So See, that's why John lays so much emphasis. Oh, I'm telling you these things that you might believe, because if you believe the way I believe, John said, if you believe the way I believe, it'll change your life. It will hold the key to solving everything that you ever encounter. John, at the end of his life, wanted people to have the record that would enable them to believe as he believed. Well, let's go on. Let's look a little further. John chapter 4, verse 39. This is Jesus had been with the woman at the well in Samaria. Many of the Samaritans of the city believed on him for the sayings of the woman, who testified, "He told me all the things I ever did." When the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he would tarry with them, stayed there a couple of days, and many more believed because of his own word. So here were people that heard what he said, and they believed. They told the woman, they said, "Now we believe, not because of what you said. We've heard him for ourselves, and know that this is indeed the Messiah, the Savior of the world." We believe that, because they heard his message. Coming on down, chapter 4 and verse 50. This is where Jesus encountered the nobleman. And finally, Jesus told him, verse 50, "Go your way, your son lives." And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. That ended the discussion. He went back. He believed what Jesus said. That settled it. He acted on what he believed. Jesus said, "You can go home. Your son's fine." The man believed him, so he said, "Thanks very much." When he was going down, his servants met him, told him his son lives. He inquired when the son began to get better, you know, when did he begin to mend? And they said, "Well, yesterday, about the seventh hour." The father knew it was at the same hour in which Jesus had said, "Your son lives." And he believed. He himself believed, and his whole house. He went and he told them, and they believed. Continuing on, John chapter 5, in verse 24. "Truly, I say unto you, he that hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death to life." Now, if you hear Christ's word and you believe on him that sent him, that's the key to life, if you really believe. Now we're going to see a little bit more about that as we go on through the Gospel of John just a little further. Notice on down in verse 42, Jesus is talking to some of the religious leaders. He said, "I know you, that you have not the love of God in you. I'm come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. If another comes in his own name, him you will receive. How can you believe, which receive honor one of another, and seek not the honor that comes from God only? Don't think that I'm going to accuse you to the Father. There's one that accuses you, even Moses, in whom you trust. If you had believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me. If you believe not his writings, how are you going to believe my words?" Oh. So believing Christ and believing the Old Testament go hand in hand together, don't they? Believing what Moses wrote. If you don't believe what Moses wrote, then you're not going to believe Christ's words. So you've got to take the whole Bible. You've got to take what the Old Testament and the New Testament. And he says, you can't really believe, we saw in verse 44, because you're a lot more interested in receiving honor from one another than receiving honor from God. You see, what's most important? Who's most real to you? Are you more interested in impressing people? You know, there are a lot of folks that are. They're really concerned about what other people think. Well, if you really believe God, then you'll be more concerned about what God thinks than what anybody thinks. And that was the problem. These people wanted the approval of other people. Well, you'll want the approval of those who are most important to you. And so if other people are more important than God, then you'll crave the approval of those other people, and therefore you will do things to gain that approval. If God's approval, if God's more real to you than anything or anyone, then God's approval is more important to you than anybody else's approval. And so if you're going to have to disappoint either people or God, you'll choose to disappoint people every time. Because God's approval is what you really crave. That's what you want. See, that's the kind of belief that changes your life. And it's the only thing that produces permanent obedience. You know, we look around, we're delighted to have a big crowd like this in Myrtle Beach. But some of you remember back to Feast Sites a few years ago, where there were multiple thousands. I remember being in Big Sandy, Texas, when there were 13, 14,000 people. Where are all those folks? Well, you know, a lot of them aren't anywhere. Clearly, everybody who sat there did not believe to the same extent, did they? Well, let's go on. Here in John chapter 6, verse 29. Jesus answered and he said unto them, "This is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he has sent." You know, this is what God wants you to do, to believe. To believe on me. Verse 40. "This is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which sees the Son and believes on him may have everlasting life. I'll raise him up." Well, you come on down a little bit later, we find that Jesus here begins to say some things that were a little hard to be understood. And some of his disciples, John 6:66, went away, walked no more with him. Jesus said to the 12, "Will you also go away?" And Simon Peter said, "Lord, to whom will we go? You have the words of eternal life." I maybe didn't understand exactly what you just said, but I know there's nowhere else to go. "We believe and are sure that you're the Christ, the Son of God." You're the Christ, you're the Messiah, you're the Son of the living God. We know that. May not understand everything you say or why you do all the things you do, but we know that. And so we're going to stay. Well, as you come on down chapter 7, we find in verse 31, many of the people believed on him. They said, "When the Christ comes, will he do more signs than what this man has done?" And you come on down a little further, and we're told here in verse 48. You know, so this is when the blind man was healed. And the Pharisees said, "Well, look, you know, some of the people, well, they sent..." This is actually before the blind man was healed. They had sent officers to arrest him, and the officers came back without him. And the Pharisees said, "What's wrong with you? Why haven't you brought him?" And the officer said, verse 46 of John 7, "We never heard anybody speak like this man speaks." And the Pharisees said, "Are you deceived? Have any of the rulers of the Pharisees believed on him? We don't believe on him. Why should you?" This people that knows not the law, they're cursed. They're not smart as we are. Well, you come on a little further. And in John chapter 8, and verse 31, Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him. See, they claimed to believe, but how deeply did they believe? Jesus describes the kind of belief he's talking about. "If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. You'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free." To continue, to dwell in, to abide in. All it's translated several different ways. So you've got to abide in, to continue in his word. Well, there are many other places that we could look as you just go through. John 10:37, Jesus said, if I don't do the works of my Father, don't believe me. You know, put it to the test. Am I doing what the Father sent me to do? But if I do, though you believe not me, believe the works, that you may know and believe that the Father's in me and I in him. Notice in John 11 and verse 15, Jesus told the disciples, this is why he waited to go to raise Lazarus. He said, I'm glad for your sake that I wasn't there, to the intent that you may believe. You know, I want you to believe. I want you to know and to understand and to comprehend the power of God. In John chapter 12, in verse 36, and I'm leaving out a number, but you can go through and read the book of John and just look at all the places the word believe is used. John 12, 36, while you have light, believe in the light, that you might be children of the light. These things spoke Jesus and departed and did hide himself from them. Jesus went on to explain in John chapter 13, in verse 19, I tell you before it comes, that when it comes to pass, you may believe that I am he. You may believe. You know, I'm explaining to you what's going to happen. When it happens, you'll know. He told them in John 14, 1, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He told them, as you go on through John 16, John 17, let's notice here in John 19. John 19, verse 35. Verse 34 talks about one of the soldiers piercing his side and blood and water pouring out. One of the others standing, notice verse 35. He that saw it bore record, and his word is true. And he knows that he says true, that you may believe. See, John saw it happen. He bore record. These things were done that the scripture might be fulfilled. Well, he goes on down into chapter 20. And the women came, and the tomb was empty. They went back and told the disciples. They came running back to tell the disciples that, you know, they've seen these angels and Jesus was raised from the dead. You put the story with the other gospels they had actually seen the angel. They came running back, and of course, you know what the men did? They said, obviously, these women have got it all mixed up. A couple of us better go down there and find out what's really going on. So Peter and John decided to go down there. And as it mentions here, verse 3 of John 20, Peter therefore went forth and that other disciple and came to the sepulcher. They both ran together. The other disciple did outrun Peter. This was about 60 years earlier, but John still remembers. You know, I beat him to the tomb. I got there first. Always could outrun old Peter. He did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulcher. And stooping down, he looked in and he saw the linen clothes lying, but he didn't go in. You know, just sort of a sense of awe. He stood there and he looked. Well, Peter came huffing and puffing up behind, and he went running right on into the sepulcher. And he saw the clothes lying. And the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. By the way, just this verse alone proves that the Shroud of Turin is a fake. If you've ever seen a picture of that, it is one continuous cloth. Supposedly has the imprint from head to foot. Well, it says right here that Jesus' head and the rest of his body was wrapped separately. There was a napkin about his head and the rest of the cloth about his body, and they were wrapped and they were folded and they were both laid together, but in different spots. So, you know, sometimes forgers just don't ever bother to actually read the text, and most of the people who are arguing over it never actually read the account of the only person who was an eyewitness and actually saw what was there. I mean, John looked in, he saw it, he knew what was there, and so he wrote it. The napkin, it wasn't lying with the linen clothes, it was wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciple which came first to the sepulcher, and he saw and believed. Evidently, John was the first one to really believe. He walked in, he saw it, and he knew what happened. He knew it. The rest of them, it was a little later. As you come on down, see Mary, she didn't really believe. She couldn't take it in. Jesus appeared to her. She then believed. The disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. In verse 19, Jesus came and stood in the midst. Thomas wasn't there. So a little later, the others saw Thomas and said, "Thomas, the Lord's alive. We saw him." Good old optimistic Thomas. He said, verse 25, "Until I see his hands, till I see in his hands the prints of the nails, till I put my finger in the print of the nails and I thrust my hand into his side, I'm not going to believe it. He's dead, fellas. I saw his cold, dead body come down and lay in that grave. I don't know what happened, but he's dead." Well, guess what? A week later, they were together and Thomas was there and Jesus, the door was shut. But see, that wasn't a problem to Jesus anymore. He just stood right there in the midst of them. Boom, there he was. He looked over at Thomas. He said, "Thomas, come here. I want you to take your finger and I want you to behold my hand. And while you're at it, here, take your hand and thrust it into the hole in my side. Don't be faithless, but believing." Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said, "Thomas, because you've seen me, you believe. Blessed are those which have not seen and have believed." He was talking about you and me. See, we weren't there. We didn't see. We weren't able to reach in our hand. But we have the eyewitness accounts and we believe. "Many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name." That's why the book of John was written. And of course, it ends up in verse 24, "This is the disciple which testifies of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true." John is the one who wrote this book. He gave an eyewitness account. He wrote it that you might know that Jesus is really the Son of God. He really is. He's the Messiah, the Son of God, and that knowing that, believing that, you and I can have life. Because if we really truly believe that from the bottom of our hearts, it will change and transform our lives forever.